everyone. I'm Matt Lachlan, along with me, the coach, Ed Lyons, and we welcome you to this afternoon's ball game. And Eddie, this is a rematch of the championship that took place 2 years ago, a double overtime thriller. Montclair came away with the crown, and I don't know if this game can match that one in excitement, but both teams are primed and pumped.
They talk about that one as probably the greatest final that has ever taken place in the 39-year history of this tournament. I thought it would never end that day.
It was a double overtime victory for the Mounties, and it was the only overtime final in the illustrious history of this tournament. Seton Hall Prep comes into the game, Eddie, undefeated. They are 22-0. What kind of pressure are they facing because of that undefeated season to date?
Well, I've always been superstitious. You are facing pressure. You know it has to come sometimes, but there's also been a lot of teams that have gone through and ended up 28-0. And some of the pressure's taken off by those two big guys they have inside.
We'll talk about them in just a moment. That's Tom Cook and Franz Volsi. First, though, let's talk a little bit about Montclair. They're on a roll. They've won 10 consecutive ball games, and during that streak, they've changed their lineup a little bit. They have players who normally would start coming off the bench. One of them who gives them a big lift is Fred Matthews.
Yeah, Fred's a 6'1" outside shooter, and he's probably their best scorer. They call him instant offense. Interesting story about that is that he wasn't there one day 10 games ago, and Quintus McDonald, of course, who's a great football player, was on a recruiting trip, and Bob started a different lineup, and they won 10 straight. So superstitious or whatever, he keeps starting the same five guys, and these two guys come in off the bench.
But it always does seem that a Montclair team under Bob Lester, or any Bob Lester team, when it comes tournament time, they're ready. So that roll from the midway point of the season on is not unexpected, really.
Oh, as you said to me when we were talking earlier, Bob seems to know the tournament and know what it takes to win in this tournament. He's been in the finals, I believe it's 10 times, you know, between the six straight down at East Orange and now four straight up here.
That's an incredible record. He's been coaching in Essex County for 12 years. 10 times he's brought a team to the final of this tournament. The other two times they made it to the semifinal round. So he's just an outstanding coach. Seton Hall, as we mentioned, 22-0. You talked about their big players. Let's talk a little bit about the junior center, Franz Volsi.
Yeah, I saw him opening game against East Orange High School. I think he's exceptional. I think both he and Cook, in my humble opinion, are both outstanding Division I prospects. I think they haven't come anywhere near reaching their potential yet. They're going to be fine college players on a Division I level. Good players.
Volsi is the leading scorer for the Pony Pirates, and he's only been playing the game of basketball since the eighth grade. He's a native of Haiti, and the national game there is soccer. He was a soccer goalie, but he's grown. He's 6'8", and basketball is where his future lies.
Yeah, they probably couldn't get the ball in the goal. He could dive both ways and keep it out of there. He's tough inside. He's, for only having played the game a short period, he seems to have a grasp of the game. I really liked him. I thought he was the most outstanding player I've seen this year.
Meanwhile, Tom Cook is familiar to all basketball fans, and in particular to Seton Hall Prep fans. He started now for 3 years, and when he was a freshman, he was kind of gangly. He had the big body, but he hadn't really matured and hadn't grown into that body. Now he's physically mature, and he is an excellent ball player.
Yeah, he's a fine outside shooter, probably a better shooter than Volsi. In fact, he played in that that double overtime game. He was a sophomore then. He's strong now. I know his father, and he's starting to get built like his father. He's strong, and he can shoot, and he can go to the boards, and he's just a good all-around player. They're two tough guys to stop.
Well, that's going to be the key to this game. Montclair is a much smaller team. They are faster, but they are smaller, and it's just a matter of who's going to win out. Can Montclair force the tempo, get Seton Hall out of its zone and out of its half-court offense? If they can, the Mounties should be successful. If not, if Seton Hall can set up in that half-court offense, the Pony Pirates could come away with their 23rd victory of the year and their fourth Essex County title. Well, we talked about some of the players. We set the stage for the game. What did the coaches think about the 39th championship? Steve Mayer had an opportunity to speak with both head coaches and get their feelings on today's game.
Steve, to beat Seton Hall Prep, it's going to take a tremendous ball game on our part. We're going to have to play at least 30 minutes of spectacular basketball. The two big kids, Cook and Volsi, are almost unstoppable if you let them get the ball in the position that they want it. We're going to have to work hard on our denial defense, and if they lob the ball, we're going to have offside help. There's no question in my mind that the strength of Seton Hall is in their front court.
Well, Steve, Montclair doesn't throw any tricks at you. They're going to come at us with a press. They're going to bang the offensive boards, and they're going to try to run on every turnover and every offensive rebound. So we're going to have to cut down on our turnovers in the backcourt We're going to have to get at least a break even on the backboards, and we're going to have to get in our half-court offense and get the ball into Volsi and Cook.
Do you think there might be some added pressure on your ball club because you come into this contest undefeated?
I really don't think so, Steve. We've been undefeated for the whole season, and our kids have played the game. They have not tried to play the opponent. They haven't looked at the opponent and said, this is what it'll take to win. They've just played the game. They've tried to go without making turnovers and stay with our game plan, and I think we'll do that today.
The thoughts of today's coaches, Bob Farrell from Seton Hall Prep, Bob Lester from Montclair, as they relayed their feelings on today's game to Steve Mayer. A little later on at halftime, Steve has a very special treat. He'll be providing a look at some of the great players that we've seen in the 7 years that we've televised the ECT, this being our eighth championship. We think it'll match the excitement of the previous seven that we've brought to you. We invite you to stay with us. The opening tap is right after this. We're back at Walsh Auditorium, Matt Lachlan along with Ed Lyons, and we're about ready for the start of today's game between Seton Hall and Montclair, the 39th annual championship of the Essex County Boys Tournament. The officials for today's game, and it's a veteran crew on the left-hand side of your screen, Joe McArdle, and he's joined by Rich Sanfilippo today.
Well, it should be a good one, Matt.
It really should be. Let's meet the starting lineups. First for the visiting team, Montclair, the third-seeded club. Dave Cummings, Timmy Riddick, and Sean Jennings will be the guards as they go to a three-guard offense. The forwards, Kyle Anglin and Adam Rohde. Meanwhile, for Seton Hall, Matt Lasher, Floyd McRae are the guards. Franz Volsi is the center. Tom Cook and Terry Lally will be the forwards.
Seton Hall is the home team.
There's Bob Lester. He's always nervous. He's been here before. Sixth year at Montclair, 126 wins, 30 losses. A truly great coach. Seton Hall controls the tap.
Looks like he was saying a little prayer, Matt. Montclair in a tough man-to-man starting out.
This is Tom Cook, rims the basket, and the rebound is taken down by Adam Rohde. Here's Sean Jennings. Dishes off for Anglin, and his jumper is good.
And that's what Montclair wanted to do. They wanted to get out in front so that Seton Hall cannot control the tempo of this game.
Knocked away by Anglin. Seton Hall will maintain possession. Yeah, Montclair does not want to fall behind. They feel that if Seton Hall has the opportunity to set up in its half-court offense with a big front court like Cook and Volsi, that Montclair would be in trouble. Here's Lasher, the junior guard. Volsi has the ball, watched by Rohde. Lally inside for McRae. Good fake, and McRae will be at the line to shoot two.
Brought the big guys out and then dumped the ball into Lally, the small guy inside, and he took him up in the air, and he's going to go to the line for two.
Tim Riddick picks up the foul. That's his first, the first on the team. Bobby Fair recovers.
Montclair's in that 1-3-1 that they've used so successfully all year with big Franz Volsi right there in the middle. Don't come down the middle.
The Seton Hall fans have obviously selected Dave Cummings to harass. Every time the senior touches the ball, they start to razz him and cheer. And we're going to have an offensive foul called against Dave Cummings, I believe. Yes, it is. An offensive foul charged against the 5'9 guard. His first, the second on the team.
Trying to go for a touchdown. They got it into the end zone, but unsuccessfully.
But it was intercepted by Rohde. Here's Anglin. The junior goes in the corner. The long jumper by Riddick is no good. Oh, what a move.
That was a nice move, Matt. I was just, you got ahead of me there. Hung in the air.
Sean Jennings makes it a 4-2 game. Here's McRae down the other end. A blocking foul will be called on Riddick, and McRae will be at the line looking to complete a three-point play.
That's one of those real tough calls. I think Joe McArdle called it right, though. He really didn't have the good position down there. I saw McRae go to the hoop, and I thought he was going to charge, but I think they called it right.
Well, Riddick, with two personal fouls, will take a seat on the bench quickly, and Fred Matthews has come into the game.
Instant offense.
McCray with his 8.5-point average has almost reached that here in the first quarter. He's got all five Seton Hall points, and the Pony Pirates are up by a point. Anglin slices through that 1-3-1 and misses the shot. Seton Hall, you see, they thought they wanted to run, but they pulled up.
Now they're going to try to control the game. They like to play that half-court game, as you said, Matt.
Lally inside for McCray, and his shot is no good, and Montclair will look to run. 3-on-2, Jennings pulls up, and the Mounties take a one-point lead.
Sean Jennings.
6-5 our score, Montclair in that press. Clifford Scott in the semifinal round against Seton Hall, a game in which the Pony Pirates won by 4, 56-52. The Scotties pressed all over the court and gave Seton Hall fits, caused a lot of turnovers, and it kept them in the game. Here's a turnover, ball loose on the floor, and we're going to get a jump ball. Volsey will jump it up, I believe, with Jennings, the advantage to the 6-8 Volsey over the 6-2 Jennings.
Looks for a little back tap here, I believe, to Lasher. Over in that general direction on the left-hand side. They have a little box there. There it is.
McCray gets the tap from Volsey. Seton Hall will set it up. 5:20 left to play in the first quarter. We're just underway. Lasher's shot no good, and Cummings tracks it down. Jennings goes to Cummings. Now Montclair will look to set it up. Here's Matthews with the ball.
They're going to try to bring them out now, Matt.
They can. Up by a point. The defense has the onus on it.
They're going to make them play man-to-man. That's what they want to do. They're going to make them play man-to-man.
Seton Hall will try to keep that 1-3-1, pull Lasher out, and come close enough so that he is considered to be playing the man. Now Seton Hall will switch to a man-to-man.
This is where Montclair wants them.
And as soon as they go man-to-man, Montclair puts the ball in motion. Anglin will back it out. 4.5 left to play. 6-5, Montclair lead. First quarter action. Matthews, good body control by the junior. He can't get the roll, but Rohde has the rebound, and Montclair will set it up. Anglin, no good. And Tom Cook has it.
They can't get the press on if they don't score. If they can keep it from scoring down there, and it's tough for that full-court press to be put on. That's a third foul against Montclair.
That'll be the fourth foul against the Mounties. It'll be called against Kyle Anglin. For Anglin, his first, fourth on the team. So Montclair in danger of going over the 1-1 limit rather early.
As I recall, Seton Hall is a good foul-shooting team, too. The first game I saw them make, most of those guys can go up and make them.
A very good foul-shooting team and a pretty good outside-shooting team, too. Tom Cook gives the Pony Pirates a one-point lead. It's 7-6.
He's a true forward, Tom Cook. Yeah, face the basket and pop it up there.
Cummings no good, and Volsey grabs the rebound.
Did he get up?
He plays above the rim. A lot of colleges have expressed an interest in both Tom Cook and Franz Volsey.
Seton Hall seems to be trying to drive the ball inside no matter who's in there. They keep revolving in and out of the bucket down there, and they're sending small men in too. They're trying to get it in there.
Jennings, no good. Lally with the rebound. Joe Garvey, who is the tournament director of the ECT this year, says that Montclair has what he calls Quintus time. He says when the Mounties start getting feet on the boards, they'll bring in the 6'4 McDonald to get some rebounds. And so far, Seton Hall has gotten most of the rebounds. Montclair's generally only had one shot. Here we have a jump ball between Cook and Jennings.
Montclair's getting the shots, Matt. They're not making them. They've had two or three pretty good shots coming down the middle there, but they just haven't gone.
A little less than 3 minutes to play in the first quarter.
There's something you don't want to do. They got the tap that time and didn't control it. Montclair stole it.
Cummings with it, and again he hears it from the crowd. Anglin for Matthews. Matthews likes that shot. And Cook has it.
Ball won't go down.
Little bit of a lid on the hoop now for Montclair. Lasher for Lally. Inside for Volsey, and we're going to have a jump ball. Volsey and Matthews. Matthews giving good weak side help.
Yep, very good. Matthews dropped back in there, and they tied him up, and it looked like the ball came into France and hit him right in the chest.
Well, you can see that Volsey is really still kind of learning the game. He's only been playing it, as we mentioned, since the eighth grade. He's only a junior, and you can see that he's got a lot of talent, but it's raw.
Exactly.
Raw ability, but the colleges want him because you can teach a player to play. You can't teach him to be 6'8 or 6'9.
And be as coordinated as he is right now.
That's right. Tom Cook with the follow has 4 points. Only two players have scored for Seton Hall. Floyd McCray has 5. Cook has 4. It's a 3-point Pony Pirate lead.
Boy, they close up that thing when Matthews gets the ball. They play that zone very well.
Well, Matthews likes that shot from the wing, foul line extended. There's a bad pass. Anglin wasn't looking for it. He was cutting toward the hoop, and Volsey with the easy interception.
They look to Lasher all the time to control the offense, and there's a pass inside. And how about that move?
With the left hand.
Yeah, for a raw talent.
Volsey with his first 2 points, a natural right-hander, went up with the left hand. Point lead. McDonald is at the scorer's bench, and he will come in at the next break in action. Anglin with the drive and the banker.
You know, you used the word, and you know what I call Anglin? He's like a slicer. He slices between. He's a slender kid, and he slices between those gaps, and he's a good shooter when he gets there.
Here's a steal. Matthews, bad shot. I think he was looking for the foul. No foul was called. Cook puts it up. What are we going to get a call? Rich Sanfilippo will have the call. It'll be a blocking foul on Rohde, and Bob Lester, Rudy Bowen, and Sandy Hunter are livid across the way.
Let's see that again. I think Bob might have it. I think that's a charge. You know, it's tough when you're on the move out there and you can't get after the officials, but I think that could have gone the other way.
Rohde will come out of the game. And he has been replaced by McDonald. Tom Cook, the junior forward out of Elizabeth, is at the line. He'll be shooting 2.
Rohde got himself back there quickly, and he established position.
Points now for Cook. Seton Hall has a 4-point lead at 12-8, less than a minute to play in the first quarter, 50 seconds showing on the clock. Here's Jennings right away. They go inside to McDonald, and we're going to get a foul called on Volsey. You know, McDonald is not that big at 6'4 in a basketball sense, he's not that big, but
strong.
He is strong.
You don't play Division I football at schools like Penn State and as a linebacker if you're not strong.
This morning he made up his mind to go to Penn State, signed a letter of intent to play for the Nittany Lions, and Joe Paterno is smiling somewhere. McDonald is not a good free throw shooter. Averaging a little less than 9 points per game. Seton Hall has made a change in its lineup. Terry Lally has come out of the game. Mark Madden, a sophomore, has replaced him.
Very good-looking prospect. I think he's a transfer from Milburn High School, and I remember him from opening night. He's a good player for a sophomore. He's a good shooter, and he goes to the offensive board very well.
Stands at 6'2". He wears number 20. Jennings fans the outside jumper. Sean Jennings has 6 points, and it's a 2-point game. And now a turnover, and Montclair will have a chance to draw even. 26 seconds left in the first period.
There's that press you were talking about that brought the turnovers against Clifford Scott, and they're getting them here tonight. Looks like they might go for the last one here and go for the tie.
7 seconds left in the first quarter. Here's Matthews. Now goes to Anglin, and it's blocked away by Volsey. And at the buzzer, the long one-handed heave by Matt Lasher is wide to the left.
There was Volce right in the middle again. Stay out of the middle.
First quarter has come to a conclusion. It's a two-point game. Seton Hall on top, 12-10. Stay with us. We'll be back right after this. We're about ready for the start of second quarter action. Matt Lachlan along with Ed Lyons. And the tap to start things is knocked around. And let's see, Montclair will pick it up.
That's twice now that Volce's gotten the tap, but Montclair's able to affect a steal of some type. Still feeling each other out, Matt.
Volce, high over the rim, grabs the rebound. Seton Hall has Matt Lasher and Floyd McRae at the guard positions. Volce is the center. Mark Madden and Tom Cook are the forwards. Here's Cook. Open shot from the foul line. No good. McDonald has the rebound. Here's Montclair looking to run. Nice pass. Cummings to Matthews. And we're tied at 12.
There's that break, and they get the press on right away. And a turnover.
And a chance to take the lead.
Let's take a look at Matthews' basket. Beautiful pass right there. Cummings to Matthews, takes it in, incidental contact, right up and in.
Jennings to Cummings, shot partially blocked by Volce. Montclair gets it, Cummings puts it up, and he has 2 points. And here comes that press. Once again, giving Seton Hall some trouble. Lasher double team, gets it to McRae, ahead to Volce. It's 2-on-1. Volce puts it up. Offensive foul.
Well, when you're refereeing out there, you can't win. Now Volce doesn't think he did it. I thought he did that time.
And a timeout called by Seton Hall as Volce picks up his second personal foul.
Let's take a look at it. Here he comes in. Goes right over him. The defender was like weaving a little bit, but you got to call a charge on that.
The seeds have stood up in the Essex County tournament. Montclair, the number 3 seed in the final, defeated the number 2 seeded Barringer in the semifinals. Montclair opened up with a win over Columbia, 59-49. And it must have been a nostalgic night when former Central player Bob Lester had to take on his old high school and defeat Central to advance to the semifinals, Montclair winning 78-68. And then Montclair, as we said, defeated the number 2 seeded Barringer Bears, 64-51 in the semifinals. Seton Hall, meanwhile, was seeded number 1 in the tournament. They defeated Glen Ridge by a score of 50-29. And those 29 points, the lowest total of points scored in a first-round game. And that's the lowest amount of points scored in any ECT game since 1966 when Weekwake defeated that Lady of the Valley 42-20. So they put a defensive job on the Ridgers.
That was that great Weekwake team that had all those 6-2 and overs. Go ahead, Matt.
And then Seton Hall wound up beating East Orange 59-48 and then advanced to the final by defeating last year's champion Clifford Scott by 4, 56-52. That game even closer than the score indicated because two of those points were scored with 1 second left. Volce on a turnaround after a missed foul shot.
Seton Hall won the championship of East Orange. They beat both East Orange schools.
Yes, they did. They won the Battle of the Oranges. Although I don't think they played Orange this year, and many have said that Orange might have been the best team in the tournament.
I heard that. There's Mr. Volce again.
Volce blocking the ball, the shot of Jeff Mills. Mills has come into the game during that last timeout. He replaced Anglin in the lineup. Here's Lasher.
Good defense by Montclair.
Madden goes to McRae. Cook, turn around. He's got it.
Got the roll that time. Off the front rim.
I said Anglin was replaced by Mills. It was Cummings who has come out of the game. So this is about as tall a lineup as Montclair will have in there. Mills goes at 6'4". Jennings is 6'2". McDonald is 6'4". Anglin is 6'3". And Matthews is 6'1". And there's Anglin.
I like Anglin. He can put the ball home.
A 57% field goal shooter. 16-14, two-point lead. Lasher double-team, gets it across to McRae. And an offensive that's a foul called against McCray. No, no foul will be called. They'll just say that the ball went out of bounds.
Right.
Montclair
wondering.
Basketball.
Yep. I'll tell you, Montclair's playing a good, tough man-to-man, and Seton Hall doesn't look like they're dominating them at all. They're two down.
Yes, they are, 16-14. Turnovers, 8 for Seton Hall, 3 for Montclair. Matthews uses the glass, no good. Mills has his shot knocked away. Chance for the Pony Pirates to tie.
Seton Hall does a good rebounding job. They got 4 or 5 rebounders. Everybody's in there, and they over the top.
Quintus McDonald picks up his first personal foul. Montclair is over the limit, so Volsey will be at the line shooting a 1-1. Montclair has Kyle Anglin and Fred Matthews at the guard positions. McDonald is playing center, and Sean Jennings and Jeff Mills are playing at the forward spot.
Volsey fought for position that time, and he battled in there pretty good, and the only option McDonald had when he got the ball was to foul him.
Volsey, leading scorer on the team, averaging 15.5 points. He has 4 today, and we're tied at 16.
I think this is where Montclair wanted to be at this time. They just didn't want Seton Hall to break out and control this thing.
Anglin for Mills, loses the handle. Volsey has to be careful. He has 2 personal fouls. Doesn't want to pick up his third here in the second quarter. 4:33 still to play in the first half. Anglin, no good. Lasher in the key with the rebound.
Like I just said a minute ago, they all rebound. The whole ball club. The small players and the big players. To get that ball inside. Now they got a double post down there. There's a battle going on. Volsey and Quintus down there.
Those two are really fighting for position down low. Ball last touched by Tom Cook. He disappears behind the stage and he'll take a curtain call.
Good one, Matt.
Montclair ball. Tied at 16. Matt Lachman along with Ed Lyons. 39th annual ECT Boys Championship. Both teams have won the title 3 times, looking to make it 4. McDonald inside is hammered by Tom Cook. And for Cook, his first, the 3rd on the team.
This is the second 2-shot foul for Quintus McDonald. As Matt said earlier, he's not an exceptional foul shooter.
Missed his first 2 and trying to atone here. Much better field goal shooter than a free throw shooter. Averaging 10.3 rebounds. Hitting 67% of his field goals, only 42% of his free throws. And he's 1-for-4 today. 1 point, Montclair lead. Cook goes to McCray. Has it knocked away by Anglin. Volsey has it. And the rebound goes to Mills.
And here come the Mountains.
3-on-2. Matthews goes around. Cook puts it up. No good. Tapped up and in by Jennings. Knocked away by McDonald. Jennings in the lane is fouled and will be at the line for 2. The foul call on Matt Lasher. And Montclair, which can score points in bunches, has put a little streak together right here.
No question, that press is bothering them, Matt. They can get into the locker room. There's still 3:25 to go, and not let Montclair pull away here. They're going to have to solve that press.
And if Montclair could hit its free throws, they'd have a little bigger of a lead. They're only 1-for-5 from the line today. Jennings averaging a little over 8 points per game.
Ooh, a brick.
Missed that one. Very short. Caught me off guard there with that comment.
You could see it when he let it go.
So we stay at 19-16. Ooh, McCray, I thought might have traveled. Bounces a pass into traffic and it's stolen. Matthews is fouled by McCray. A little bit of frustration on McCray's part, I'm sure.
Well, they're really doing a good job the last 5-6 minutes denying the ball to Volpe inside.
At the line for Montclair, Fred Matthews.
Watch this.
McDonald and Volsey battling for some position.
Boy, they have him ringed, don't they? Look at that. As you say, that wasn't weak side help. He came from the front that time, and Matthew slipped in there and made a good play.
John Bennett has come into the game for Seton Hall as Matthews hits his first free throw. He'll have another. He has 3 points today. Bennett is a senior out of Newark, and he has replaced Volsey in the lineup. Maybe Bobby Farrell saw the battle going on down low and didn't want Volsey to get his third. He's got two. Seton Hall have to hustle to get it across the timeline, and they do. Here's Cook. He'll go right to the hoop and now pulls up. He's short. McDonald with the rebound.
Quintus time.
He is a house. Here's Mills. His shot is short, and Madden has the rebound. The sophomore breaks out of the pack. Ahead for Cook to Bennett. Nice spinning move by John Bennett, and he gets the roll.
Nice play all the way around. A little spin, an old-fashioned one-hander.
21-18, a three-point Montclair lead. 2.5 left to play in the first half. A reminder that at halftime, Steve Mayer will take a look at some of the past games that we've brought to you in the ECT, a look at some of the great names that have participated in this tournament during the years that TV3 has had the privilege of televising the game. And here we're going to have a foul called on Freddie Matthews. Offensive foul called on Matthews.
That was not what Bob Lester wanted at all. He had a three-point lead. He wanted him to spread out, force Seton Hall to come out man-to-man, and instead Matthews went down the middle. Now, Volsey's not in the middle anymore, but he picked up the foul. Not a good play.
And you see Bob Lester tapping the side of his head saying, you've got to think out there. Bob's a real animated coach. I think he's mellowed a little bit,
yeah,
but he's still very animated. Here's a steal, a near steal anyway, by Dave Cummings. Cummings has just come back into the game replacing Sean Jennings.
Matt, they've done that a few times as Seton Hall has started to go to the basket. Boy, those quick hands are in there from the Mounties and taking the ball away. Now it's Bennett, and now Montclair for the first time is in the zone. They're in a 2-3. Stay out of foul trouble, protect that lead a little bit, and
Montclair has its football team just about in there.
They all play?
All except Kyle Anglin. Here's Bennett, hard off the glass. Mills has the rebound. Mills, McDonald, Cummings, and Matthews all play football. And Jeff Mills travels with the ball. I know they're very high on Jeff Mills as a future football prospect. He's only a junior, 6'4", 220 pounds.
Lineman?
Linebacker. Real quick.
Boy, they got a football tradition at Montclair.
You know, I was thinking the other day, at TV3 we did a story on the South River football tradition, and South River has several players playing professional football, and for a small community, that's a great story. But Montclair, you go back to Clary Anderson.
Clary Anderson years.
Boy, they had some great teams. Bennett has a shot knocked away by Anglin. Cummings comes away with it. It's a two-on-two. Cummings with McDonald. Nice bounce pass. And McDonald has the layup. And it's up to a five-point lead.
Actually, Montclair is dominating the tempo now. And Seton Hall is in big trouble.
Cummings, no good. Ball comes out. Who's got it? Freddie Matthews. Away by McCray.
Well, let's take a look at that last McDonald basket. Cummings down the middle, nice pass. Quintus handles that one. Nobody wants to get in his road.
I was just going to say, McCray said, no, I think I'll just slide out of the way and let you get the hoop.
I'll pass on the charge.
Can't blame him. McDonald 6'4", 225. Football All-America.
Now they're going to bring him out to the man-to-man. I still think that Montclair has dominated the tempo just as Bob Lester planned, and they will not shoot now.
Montclair has scored 6 points off the fast break. Seton Hall, which really doesn't have much of a fast break.
Not looking to break. They have to. They get 8 or 9 points behind.
They will. 15 seconds left. Near steal by Madden. Matthews recovers. 12 seconds left. Now 10. Matthews on the drive. No good. But he'll be at the line shooting two.
Called it on Bennett.
Bennett picking up his first personal foul. 8 seconds remain. Matthews will be at the line shooting two. Montclair leading by five over the undefeated Seton Hall Prep Pony Pirates, a team that many consider to be the best team in the state. Montclair, though, don't forget, a hot ball club right now. They've won 10 straight. Matthews is 3 for 3 from the line today. All his points coming here in the second quarter. He has five. A 69% free throw shooter, so odds are he'll miss this one. But he's 4 for 4.
The Mounties definitely controlling the game, and the press has done it for them.
Well, I'll tell you, Clifford Scott, as Cook loses the ball out of bounds, Clifford Scott's press really confused Seton Hall and kept the Scotties, who have talent, don't get me wrong,
right,
but kept them in the game against a bigger team.
I think they have to try to go up court further with it. You know, break a big guy like Bolte back in and go up court.
Matthews hard off the back iron. Lasher no good. And his shot at the buzzer will be short. But Montclair has opened up a 7-point lead. They were down by two after one. They lead by seven going to the locker room, 25-18. When we come back, we'll have our review of the ECT, plus a look at the great game that these two teams played 2 years ago in the Essex County Finals. Stay with us. Time of today's contest, 25-18. Montclair leads over Seton Hall Prep in the 39th annual Boys Essex County Tournament Championship. Since 1977, TV3 has had the privilege of bringing you the championship of this tournament. And in this feature report, Steve Mayer takes a look at some of the great names that have helped teams to wins since 77.
1977, and the first year TV3 broadcast the final, that was the year Kelly Trapuka, the big star of Bluefield High School. Kelly still holds most of the records for ECT scoring, but this was the year that the Bluefield Bengals were upset by East Orange in the final. In 1978, Marvin Wiggins of Valley was the big star. Wiggins did it offensively and defensively. He scored 30 points in the final contest, Valley winning their first ECT championship. The final score, 61-58. Marvin Wiggins, the star, back in 78. In 79, Valley again the winner, their second championship. Troy Webster, the big reason. Troy hitting big baskets down the stretch as Valley beat Orange 78-76. Troy Webster now playing at George Washington University. In 1980, the star for the Weequake Indians was Steve Evans here, number 44. Weequake beat Valley in the final. For Weequake, their fourth title. Steve Evans did a great job filling the lane on the break. He also received a lot of passes from Robert Golden. Golden the leader in assists, Evans the leader in points with 24. In 1981, East Orange, the winner over Shabazz in the ECT final, and Tony George, the big reason. George had 28 points in the final, as East Orange was the surprise winner in 1981. Tony George, an All-Stater in East Orange. 1982, and a victory for the Montclair Mounties. Curtis Ridgewood, the star, and this year, Ridgewood had 16 points in the first half, 30 points for the game. Ridgewood came in averaging 18 points a game, bettered his average as Montclair won their second championship. Their third championship the following year, and this time an unexpected hero. Paul DeMuro, a senior who only averaged 5 points a game throughout the year, hit three big baskets down the stretch as Montclair beat Seton Hall Prep in two overtimes, maybe the biggest victory ever for Montclair high school basketball. The following year, Robert Oden, the star for Clifford Scott. As Clifford Scott won their second championship, they drubbed Montclair in the ECT final, Oden with 24 points. Well, as you've seen, there's been some great players in ECT finals. There have also been some great games. Maybe the greatest of them all, 2 years ago, the 1983 ECT final between these same teams.
The Montclair Mounties and the Seton Hall Preps did battle. Let's now take a look at what happened back in 1983, Montclair against Seton Hall Prep. Montclair led throughout the game and in fact went up by 8 with just 3:15 to go.
Corner jumper is good.
The Prep though hung tough, and they made a comeback that their fans will never forget.
Seton Hall with problems inbounding, get it ahead to Taylor. No walk called, and Unger gets the basket. Remember, they were down by 6 to Clifford Scott, scored the last 7 points, won the ball game with 3 seconds left. Godball, turnaround is good. Uh-huh. Jones finds a lane, misses the layup. Cook gets the rebound, goes to Taylor. Seton Hall now races it into the forecourt. Taylor takes the jumper, got it!
2-point ball game. See what they're going to do.
He's double-teamed in the corner, gets it to Godbolt. Godbolt drives.
He's the man I want to have it. It's a tie ball game.
And that's the way the regulation ended, tied at 56 as Dwayne Jones' shot was off the mark for Montclair. In the first overtime, Robbie Osborne was fouled with just 4 seconds to go. With his team down by 2, Osborne calmly sank this free throw and then this free throw, and the game was tied once again. To OT number 2 we went, and for Montclair it was time for Paul DeMuro to take over.
Jones penetrates, gives it to the corner to Morton, his jumper in and out, followed by DeMuro, gets the roll! Inside the DeMuro!
It wasn't over yet, as Seton Hall had one more chance to tie it up. Tom Hart's shot fell short, and it was Montclair with the win. An ECT Classic back on February the 26th, 1983.
Well, it's February the 23rd, 1985, and do we have another classic on our hands? Well, Seton Hall Prep will have to come back in the second half if we are to have another classic. Currently at halftime, Montclair leads it by 7, 25-18. Matt Laughlin and Ed Lyons will be back the second half, coming to you right after this.
Well, we hope you enjoyed that halftime look at some of the past great players that have participated in this tournament, and a look back at the game 2 years ago played between Seton Hall Prep and Montclair. The Mounties leading here by 7, and they are led by who I consider to be one of the greatest coaches, Bob Lester, just an outstanding basketball coach. He's been in the business for 14 years, and look at that record, 322 wins and 65 losses. It's an amazing winning percentage. He's won 4 state titles. He's won 6 county titles. He's an amazing coach.
Just an amazing record and is an amazing coach. And in the first half of this ball game, it was a clinic of what he had spoken about. Seton Hall's got to get back in here early in his third quarter and take the domination away. Have to solve the press.
You know, when he was at East Orange, I was just starting to become familiar with this area when I attended Seton Hall. He was coaching at East Orange.
Right.
And I only had an opportunity to see his teams play a couple of times, but it seems that, probably there were enough fans who said, well, he's got great talent. I could coach great talent. And he went down to Atlantic City for a couple of years, had some fine players there. Not to take anything away from these Montclair teams, but they don't match up against those East Orange teams in terms of talent, but year in and year out, they're up there 18, 19, 20 wins. One year they won 27, went to the Group 4 final. I think it's a reflection on Bob Lester. Second half underway. Montclair has Dave Cummings, Tim Riddick, Sean Jennings, Adam Rohde, and Kyle Anglin out there. This is Rohde inside for the basket.
They have Montclair in the man-to-man, and that's what they wanted, and that time they took him. When the help came up, he dumped it off to Rohde, and they get a bucket out of it.
That's the same 5 that Montclair began the ball game with. For Seton Hall, they have Matt Lasher, Floyd McCray at the guard positions, Franz Volsius the center, and Terry Lally, Tom Cook are the forwards, and Volsi cannot catch up to the pass, and on the turnover, Montclair has a chance to go up by 11.
That was Rohde fronting them good, and Montclair, as I said earlier, is still dominating the tempo of this game. They're dictating what's going to be done out there.
And Seton Hall has to be careful because they don't want to get into a running game with Montclair, a faster club than the Pony Pirates. And we're still early, 6:50 to play in the third quarter, but they're in danger of going down by 11 here. And they might look up and all of a sudden this game's out of reach. Montclair will be content to use some time on the clock.
They're running the clock a little bit now, bringing them out in that man-to-man. They're actually playing a, you know, similar to a stall offense right now. They got the middle open.
Riddick leaves it for Cummings. Cummings is watched by Lasher. Here's Anglin, guarded by Cook. And the rebound taken down by Volsey. It may be that the taller players for Seton Hall, Volsey and Cook, are going to have to begin asserting themselves and get Seton Hall back in the game. Seton Hall has a decided height advantage. They really haven't been able to take advantage of it too much. We have a whistle. Foul called on Rohde.
You think Volsey's been in a crowd all day? He's always had two or three men surrounding him.
And Bobby Farrell wants to call a timeout. That's his second timeout. He has two remaining. And he wants to talk things over as his team is down by nine. Leading scorers in the first half, Montclair led by Sean Jennings, who had eight. Matthews had six. Anglin had six. And McDonald contributed 3 points. Meanwhile, for Seton Hall, Cook had seven. Five by McCray. Four by Volsey. Six rebounds for Cook. Not a bad stat for Tommy Cook.
I'll tell you, another thing that Seton Hall seems to be doing, Matt, is they're trying to get the ball into the bucket, but they're standing still. I'd like to see a little more movement. Montclair's moving, you know, they're just...
Yeah. Montclair talking things over with Bob Lester. We saw Bobby Farrell marking some plays on the floor. There it is, with his chalk. Finn Tracy used to do that. Every once in a while, Finn came up with six players on the court.
Yeah,
Finn would just say, this, and all of a sudden, he'd say, well, coach, we only have supposed to have five out there, but he won them, didn't he?
When Dean Smith, the great Finn story, when Dean Smith first came up with the four corners, Finn was defending a lead one day, and he stood up and yelled out, go to the five corners.
The late Finn Tracy, a great basketball coach.
A legend.
Coach Seton Hall for a long, long time. Also was up at the Immaculate Conception in Montclair. And I guess his best win was in 64 when, led by Mel Knight, they defeated Weequake. Volsey, no good on the foul. He picks it up again, and he's got it.
Montclair went to a zone that time after Seton Hall had diagrammed their man-to-man plays, and I don't know if they'll stay in it or they just made a switch coming out of a, you know, timeout.
Here's a foul on McCray. For McCray, his second. First on Seton Hall here in the second half. Montclair 11 for 30 today. Seton Hall 7 for 19.
Tells you something. They're just not getting the shots.
Right. Montclair has had 11 more field goals than Seton Hall. Now 12. Rohde travels with the ball. Rohde thought a foul might have been called on Lally.
Let's see what they do against the press this time. That's what I want them to do. Let him come back. I handled it a little better that time.
And at 6'8", they can get the ball to him up high, and he can give it back to the guards as they get a little movement.
As you said, Lasher has to keep his head up.
There's a foul on Tom Cook away from the ball, using his arm to push Kyle Anglin out of the way for Tom Cook, his second. That foul coming at an inopportune moment. It was a chance to cut the lead to five. Look at that. That's a telling statistic.
Yes, it is. Eight more. All done by the quickness of the press.
Montclair leading by seven. 5:05 left to play in the third quarter.
Montclair not in a big hurry to shoot either. See, the Seton Hall is not as quick, and their man-to-man is not as aggressive. It's more passive. There's a steal.
Lally gets it to Lasher. Lasher's one-on-two. Loses the handle. It was knocked out of bounds by a Mountie. And Seton Hall will maintain possession. Lasher might have done a little better to back that out and wait for some teammates.
I was going to say that, Matt. You're getting to be a keen analyst.
Letty, I sit next to you long enough, I'll be able to coach a team. There's Volsey.
They finally got it inside. Now, they changed something. I'm not sure exactly what they did, but they got it into him clean that time.
It's a 5-point lead. Just a moment or so ago, Montclair had a chance to bump it up to 11.
Defense here and get a rebound and get the ball down the other end and score. They're back in there.
Cummings on the drive, partially blocked by Volsey. Last touch by Montclair.
Bosey's got about six blocks and two partials.
He started to exert himself, and I think Bob Lester has realized that because he has brought in Quintus McDonald to replace Timmy Riddick.
They're getting it up now. They're bringing guys back to help Lasher instead of trying to dribble through it.
So Volsey, who has scored 4 points, has had some rebounds and a couple of blocks here in the third quarter, will now battle a smaller but physically stronger Quintus McDonald.
Boy, look at that battle going on in there.
Looking for the alley-oop, and it eventually went off of Terry Lally.
That's a real wrestling match going on there.
They're battling. Volsey has two fouls.
I used the name the other night, and Steve Mayer knew who it was. And Quintus McDonald looks a little bit like him. Wayne Embry.
Sure. There's the third foul on Volsey.
He had the ball, but he also had the arm on that one.
Bob Farrell looking out onto the court, trying to catch the attention of his Pony Pirates.
And Quintus has been struggling at the line. He's 1 for 4.
Has 3 points today.
1 for 5. Another rebound for Cook.
Chance to make it a 3-point game. 3.5 left to play in the third quarter. Here's Lally, short on the jumper, and that'll go off of Volsey. Oh no, Rich Sanfilippo said it was last touched by McDonald.
Doesn't seem to be much complaining by Montclair down there, so he got it off somebody. I guess good call.
Rich and Joe are good officials. They call a good game.
Montclair's way back. Look at that fight going on in there between Quintus and Bolton.
And Sanfilippo is keeping a close eye on it. There's an elbow thrown by McDonald, and Sanfilippo has caught it and will whistle a foul against Quintus McDonald.
And if Rohde doesn't be quiet in there, he's going to get a big T.
Rohde went right after Rich Sanfilippo. Rohde is a captain, so is McDonald, along with Dave Cummings. Seton Hall captains Terry Lally.
Uh-oh.
There's a foul on
Volsey. Push up. Number 4.
And Volsey will have to come out of the game.
You want to know something? They might do a little better here for a while. They're really concentrating on just getting the ball to Volsey, and maybe they'll get everybody involved in the offense.
3:10 left to play in the third quarter. Bennett has come in and replaced Volsey. Last touch by Jennings as it went off of his knee out of bounds. I'm sorry to tell you, the captain, Derek Matthews, is the other captain for Seton Hall, along with Terry Lally.
Of course, when they lose Volsey as far as offense, they really lose him defensively because he's a shot blocker.
Boy, Bobby Farrell's upset.
Thinks he was hit.
That's what he's saying, Rich Sanfilippo. He hit him on the arm. Dave Oliver comes into the game for Montclair, making his first appearance, replacing Sean Jennings.
Joe McArdle and Rich Sanfilippo are good officials. They didn't even consider a tee or anything. They just walked away from him. Let him vent his anger, as I used to.
Inside for Bennett, puts it up, no good, but he'll be at the line for two as Dave Oliver picks up the personal foul.
Montclair continues to go inside. Outside early in the game, I don't remember an outside shot they made. Cook made one. Maybe McRae early.
Yeah, McRae's was a 3-point play, so that was a drive. But Seton Hall has started to go inside.
And Montclair's really collapsing back in.
Bennett makes 1 of 2. Montclair's ledger has stayed at 27 for quite a while.
I was just going to say that, Matt. We're thinking a lot alike,
aren't we?
I was just going to say, they haven't scored in a while.
It's a four-point game. They led 27-18 at one point. They scored the first basket of the second half, leading 25-18 at half. They opened it up to 27-18. They haven't scored since.
You know, basketball is a funny game, Matt. Lester wanted them in the man-to-man. And Seton Hall, they didn't think played as well man-to-man.
There's a steal and a blocking foul on Rohde.
Yeah. And since, let's watch this.
Adam Rohde, but the third personal foul charge to Rohde.
Blocking.
Tom Cook stealing the ball away.
They're making me assistant official out here with our calls.
So far you've agreed with almost all of them. Cook inside is fouled and will be at the line shooting two. Brent Matthews comes in for Montclair.
Not fouled. Mugged. Boy, I'll tell you, they just keep going down under and it's rough in there.
It really is. Not for the faint-hearted. So Cook will be at the line shooting two. If he connects on them, it'll be a two-point ball game. And we're setting up for an exciting conclusion.
Seton Hall get back in there. I'd say they're back in there now. This is what they had to do.
A three-point ball game. Cook with 8 points tonight. Gao has nine. No, this game's being played at noon. We don't do too many noon games. I said tonight, of course, I mean today. 2 minutes left in the third quarter. Two-point ball game.
And it's noisy here. The crescendo is starting to get louder.
Again, the Seton Hall fans, as they did earlier, starting to get on Dave Cummings. Every time he touches the ball, they start to razz him. Matthews has his shot blocked from behind, but Bennett also got him with the body. Second personal on John Bennett.
The man who fouled him said he didn't. The guy who got fouled said he did, and Bob Farrell said they were walking.
You can't win when you're an official.
No way.
Everybody has an opinion. Yours is the one that counts, but most times you're going to offend half the group anyway.
Have to. Here comes Madden back in.
Madden in for Bennett. Matthews has 7 points today, five of them from the line.
That's a small Seton Hall team that's in there now.
Yeah, Cook the biggest at 6'5", but Madden's only about 6'2". And it's like a square dance. Say hello to your partner and take a step back.
Dozy-do.
Yes. I think what they wanted to do is they wanted McDonald on the same side as Madden, so if Cook was going to step across, so was McDonald. Matthew's good on both. He has 8 points. It's a four-point Montclair lead. Here's Lally. Bad pass, tipped away by McDonald.
Yep.
But an equally bad pass by Oliver. Lasher does a good job keeping it alive, but McDonald steals it.
Nobody wants the ball.
Anglin way outside in front of the Montclair bench. Watched by Lally. 1:20 left to play in the third quarter. And here's a steal. Madden ahead of the field. Got it.
Smart move back there by Cummings. He didn't commit the foul and get the three-pointer. Kind of stayed with him and put the pressure on.
Two-point ball game. 60 seconds left in the third quarter. Sean Jennings will come in for Montclair at the next whistle. Blocked by Cook. Taken by McCray. McCray to Lasher. Somebody's got to be open. Cook's got it. He's going to drive. He's got it. And a blocking foul on Cummings. And a chance for Seton Hall to take the lead.
They've come back.
Have they ever?
Watch this. I'm not going to be an official on this one. I'm just going to say Cook went to the hole, went up, and they called a three-point play. I can't call it.
Well, the Seton Hall fans have erupted. A seven-point halftime deficit has been erased here in the third quarter. And a free throw by Tom Cook here will give the Pony Pirates a one-point lead.
And as I said, they've done this playing man-to-man. Basketball's a funny game.
It really is. Takes some funny bounces, that round ball, doesn't it? And here's a steal. Things starting to fall apart for Montclair. Lasher's got it.
He's hurt.
Lasher came down hard after he made the layup.
He's a quarterback. He's
taking a few knocks.
Yeah, he's been back there before. He'll be all right. Looks like he got hit in the nose or the eye.
So Bobby Farrell out there along with the Seton Hall trainer checking him out. I just saw Matt say, I'm okay.
I saw that myself. He said, I'm all right.
Gets a round of applause from the Seton Hall fans.
Just tell those linemen to keep those other guys out of here for me.
Jeff Mills has come into the game for Montclair. Lasher will take a seat on the bench, and he has been replaced by Tom Whitaker. Tom Whitaker, out of East Orange, a sophomore guard, has replaced Lasher. Jennings is back in the game for Montclair.
And Whitaker's going to get Cummings now. Staying in there man-to-man. They're not going to go back to their 1-3-1.
23 seconds left in the third quarter. A three-point Seton Hall lead.
He said, this is what brought us to the dance, and we're going to stay here.
Jennings on the drive. No good. Gets his own rebound. Has it knocked away by Madden, but a foul on Mark Madden. The sophomore picks up his first. Montclair has Fred Matthews, Dave Cummings out on the floor, along with Jeff Mills, Quintus McDonald, and Sean Jennings, who will be at the line shooting two. Seton Hall has the new man in the game, Tom Whitaker, who will come out for Matt Lasher. Lasher back in the game. Lasher and McCray the guards, Madden and Lally the forwards. Cook has moved to the center position for Seton Hall. Jennings with 8 points today. Looking to pull Montclair a little closer.
When do you think they'll reinsert Bolsey in the game? About halfway through the fourth quarter?
I think Bobby Farrell's counting his blessings because they started the comeback with him in the lineup. Once he went out, they maintained that momentum.
Right.
He's got four. He might keep him out for a while. See what this team does without him. Cook into the forecourt. Knocked away by McDonald, and it will be Seton Hall ball with 6 seconds left.
We've got to get a shot out of this now. Let's see what they do. Got that little box there. Get it back to Lasher.
3 seconds left, partially tipped by Matthews. And the third quarter will come to a close. But a good Seton Hall comeback. They were down by 7 at the half. As we prepare to play the final 8 minutes, the Pony Pirates lead by 1. We'll be back right after this.
Might have a shootout at OK.
Both of these teams, Eddie, have won 3 championships in the previous 38 years of ECC play. East Orange has won the most in the history of the tournament, 6. Shabazz won a lot of them known as Southside. They won 5. Bluefield Orange and Weequake 4. And one of these teams will join that last three teams, those last three teams, with a 4th championship after today's game. And it's half controlled by Montclair, trailing by a point. They're outscored 14-6 in the third quarter. Matthews on the drive, gives Montclair a 1-point lead.
Cook didn't want to commit the foul there. He held his ground, but they didn't step out to try to block the shot.
10 points now for Fred Matthews, and we have a blocking foul on Dave Cummings. Cummings' third personal foul. Montclair over the limit, so we'll take a walk down the other way, and Lasher will be at the line shooting a 1-1.
Lasher told the official he's been doing that to me all night. Or all afternoon.
At the line for Seton Hall, Matt Lasher. Lasher will shoot 1-1.
Pulls up a little short on it, and Mills has it. Cummings and Matthews in the backcourt. Mills, Jennings, McDonald up front for Montclair. There's a travel on Fred Matthews. Tried to get the baseline, but took an extra step. Seton Hall has Lasher and McCray in the game. Lally, Madden, and Cook up front. Franz Volsey, their 6'8 center, on the bench with 4 personal fouls. Hey. see how much longer Bob Farrell elects to keep Volsey on the bench with those four before he brings him in. Montclair up by a point. Madden fakes McDonald and hands the jumper.
That's a big one right there. They needed that one.
The sophomore from Milburn has 4 points, and Seton Hall leads by a point.
I believe that might be the first outside shot since the first quarter.
McDonald is fouled by Lally. Terry Lally picks up his first. McDonald will be at the line. He'll be shooting two. Seton Hall led by two after one. Montclair took a big lead of 7 points at the half, outscoring Seton Hall by 9 in the second quarter. Seton Hall returned the favor, outscoring the Mounties by 8 in the third quarter. Both teams have scored 2 here. Seton Hall maintains its 1-point lead, but McDonald has pulled Montclair even.
Had nice rotation on that shot, and he broke his jinx on the line. Gets them both. 2 clutch foul shots.
He's got 5. Montclair leading by a point once again. Knocked away by Jennings, but he stepped out of bounds. So he tried to knock it back inbounds. So Seton Hall has it.
You don't want to throw that ball backwards against that press. They almost had it intercepted there, but, well, they just did it again. And they succeeded that time.
But as you said, you don't want to throw it backwards against the press. Move it up court.
You know, it's a funny thing. A fast-breaking team usually plays better against the press than a slow ball control team because they're not used to doing it in practice or anything else, you know?
Madden inside with the left hand has 6 points now.
2 big goals by the sophomore here in the last quarter when they needed them.
And again, it's a 1-point lead. Kyle Anglin is at the scorer's table. He'll come in at the next break for Montclair.
Seton Hall sticks with the man-to-man.
Jennings the turnaround over Madden, and Sean Jennings has 12 points. He leads all Montclair scorers, tied with Tom Cook for team high. A game high, excuse me. Anglin now comes into the game replacing Jeff Mills, and the junior will replace a fellow junior in the lineup.
That press is still bothering them, Matt. They're right now, they're face guarding them. Now they've come up a little bit with it.
Lally across the timeline, gives it for Lasher. You know, we said earlier that Seton Hall is a young team, primarily underclassmen. Here's McCray, one of their seniors, getting fouled by Jennings. Montclair's a young team also. Jennings picks up his first personal. Both teams are over the limit for the remainder of this game. McCray will be at the line to shoot 2. But Montclair, while they have some key seniors in Cummings and in McDonald, but Riddick is a junior, Jennings is a junior, Anglin's a junior.
Could see him back here on a February day next year again.
Could very well, the last Saturday in February when the ECT is held every year. Adam Rohde is also a senior, by the way. McCray makes them both, and again, it's a 1-point lead. Well, Eddie, looks like we're going to seesaw the rest of the way.
Yep. It's always one of those in the Essex County tournament.
Yeah, there really haven't been too many blowouts. Last touch by McCray. I guess Montclair had that real bad one against Shabazz three years ago, 82.
Yep.
75-46. That was 3 championships ago.
But most of them are down the wire jobs.
Most of them really are. Last year, Scott won by 2. The year before, Montclair won by 2. Foul on Tom Cook over the top. Matthews had position on the rebound. And Cook picks up the personal foul, his 3rd.
I was just going to ask you that. He's getting up there, too.
5:20 left to play in regulation.
Matthews will be at the line.
Matthews is shooting a 1-1. He's got 10 points tonight, or today. What do you remember about your appearance in the ECT final with Clifford Scott? That was, what, 62?
62. I guess I just remember we got out to a big lead, and I remember those final 10 seconds when I knew we had it, and it was like an impossible dream because a small school had never won it, and we had gotten there, and I didn't want to let it get away. In fact, as I look up in the stands, I see Chris Kinnam, whose son plays for Seton Hall Prep. He was my captain that year.
There's a steal by Anglin on the bounce pass from Lasher. Montclair looking to open up a three-point lead. Jennings has his shot blocked away, but we have an offensive foul on Sean Jennings, his second personal foul.
Bob Lester is screaming, but not at the officials. He's screaming at Sean Jennings.
That's the second foul on Jennings.
So Seton Hall, trailing by a point, will have the ball with 5:08 to play. Do you remember what the final score of that game was, Eddie, by the way, against Seton Hall? Don't look at my notes. I saw you sneaking a quick glance.
We win about 6 or 8?
56-47. Here's Jennings, and Jennings carried the ball. And quickly, Jennings will come out of the game.
Some funny things happened. One of the players on the Seton Hall team that night was Tommy Gotzel, who many years later replaced me as Summit High School coach.
Jennings on the bench doesn't look too happy about it. Has been replaced by Timmy Riddick.
Yeah, bad couple of minutes there, Jennings.
Yeah, those two turnovers.
Well, here we go, down through that last 5 minutes.
And it's a one-point ball game. Montclair leading by that point. Cummings with the rebound. Goes to Anglin. And we'll have a jump ball. Bob Lester is up and down.
Is he animated?
He is. I do remember him from his East Orange days, and I think he has calmed down a little bit, but still, he's the same way.
Here comes the big guy.
Bolsey comes in replacing Lally.
So Lally did a very nice job in there as a replacement. He was there when they made that comeback.
Quiet night for Lally. Hasn't scored. Bolsey with 8 points, and now Montclair calls a timeout. So the Mounties will talk things over with 4:40 left to play. They lead by a point. And we'll have a jump ball at the conclusion of this timeout.
Come at the conclusion of the game. We ask all fans to remain in their seats.
You know, we mentioned earlier the Orange Tornadoes being a very fine club, and they were highly ranked, highly seeded in the upcoming state playoffs. But unfortunately, Orange will not participate in the state playoffs. It was determined that a reserve player who did not have much impact on the Orange success was in fact ineligible, academically ineligible under old NJSIAA rules, New Jersey State Interscholastic Athletic Association rules. He would have been eligible. However, the state has tightened up the academic requirements, and so consequently he was not eligible, although progressing very well. His teacher said he's doing very well in the classroom, and they felt that he was eligible. So he plays. Any game he played in, they had to forfeit. And
so
that brought them below 500.
500,
and one of the best teams in the area, in fact, one of the best teams in the state, will sit home for the rest of the playoffs.
What group are they in this year?
The Tornadoes are group two.
That opens it up for Clifford Scott and some of the other teams around here.
Controlled by Seton Hall. They trail by a point. And we're getting to crunch time. Lob for Bolsey. Madden has it, brings it right inside.
As a sophomore, has he helped them?
Six fourth quarter points for all the 6'2 sophomore. All important indeed. And again, it's a 1 point Seton Hall lead. Back and forth we go. Montclair takes a 1 point lead on the Fred Matthews jumper. Matthews has 6 fourth quarter points.
Instant offense just flipped that one up there like he knew it was going in. All the confidence in the world.
I don't want Volsey to handle the ball too much outside.
Well, let's watch it. They're going to go at it again. Quincy and Volsey. Quintus. I get my names mixed up a little bit.
McCray, who
had 5 points in the first quarter, but had been quiet since then. Now has 4 points in the fourth quarter to bump his game total to 9. And Seton Hall leads by a point. A travel is called on Matthews. Jeff Mills comes into the game replacing Kyle Anglin for Montclair.
You know, Seton Hall has never gone back to the 1-3-1. They've stayed in the man-to-man.
They have. Montclair did what they wanted to do, got them out of that zone defense. And when they had that big lead, you started to say, well, basket here or there. As Folsey misses the jam, they could have really blown this thing open, but Seton Hall came back. McCray along the baseline is tripped up by Matthews. You know, Folsey was a little too far out to try that dunk.
I was going to say, that is what you were speaking about earlier in the day. With experience and with playing the game, he'll pick up those little nuances of the game. I think he should have just gone off the backboard with that. It was a broad jump. I always used to tell the kids, when you're coming to the basket, don't make a broad jump, make a high jump. Come in there and just lay the ball against the glass. Of course, we didn't have dunkers in those days.
McCray for the 1-1. We'll have the bonus. For Fred Matthews, that was his second personal foul. Seton Hall leading by 2. McCray a perfect 6-for-6 from the line tonight. He's 7-for-7. And Seton Hall leads by 3.
To say one thing about this Hall club, they never wavered. They just persistently played their game.
Here's a steal.
Oh!
And Lasher run into each other. We're going to have a jump ball between Matthews and Lasher.
Big game, sophomore, coming down the court, and Madden goes behind his back, and I think if Lasher hadn't have been there, he'd have gotten away with it. Very key tip here. Montclair should get it, but...
Matthews with the height advantage. Lasher only 5'10", Matthews 6'1".
Seton Hall looking for a steal. It should come back in here right next to Tommy Cook here. That's where it is.
Cummings has it for Montclair. The Mounties trail by 3. Third seeded in this tournament, winners of 10 consecutive games, looking to hand Seton Hall its first loss of the year. The Pony Pirates, the number one seed in the tournament, are 22-0.
Mounties need a bucket here. They don't need to lose a possession. They need a bucket. And they got
Cummings
it.
Gets it.
A clutch bucket by Cummings, senior player.
Tri-captain has 4 points. Now we're going to get a travel or a foul. We'll get a travel called on McCray.
McCray went right into Quintus McDonald. I don't think that's a good feeling. I'd say, excuse me, Quintus.
McDonald didn't move. Chance for the Mounties to take the lead. Matthews has it knocked away by Cook. Big play by Tommy Cook.
Yes, it was. We're at crunch time now, Matt. Boy, look at the fight going on.
And McDonald gets called for the foul, pushing Franz Volsey. Volsey will be at the line. He'll be shooting a 1-1. He has 8 points today. Third personal foul on Quintus McDonald.
I'll tell you, Volsey doesn't give any ground. He's not timid.
No, he is not. Native of Haney.
He's going to be a great player, I think.
You know, they found him at Seton Hall sitting up here at Walsh up in the theater seats, which are right in the second half of the gym, watching practices, watching the kids play. And they said, well, why don't you come down and play? And
here he is.
He really didn't know the game that well. As we said earlier, soccer player, basically. But here he is. Hard off the backboard.
Yep. Big miss.
Montclair with 2 minutes left. Has the ball and a chance to take the lead.
Boy, it's been a one-pointer for a long time, hasn't it?
It really has. It was 32-31 at the end of the third quarter. Cummings from outside, no good. Volsey gets the rebound.
And a big rebound. That's what they need him in there for.
Bobby Farrell just got off the bench and said, spread it out.
Yeah, they're going to circulate now. Get a little movement. He can kind of feel it if they can hang on. Going to force it into Volsey now. They're going to spread out, go into the delay.
Seton Hall's last win in the championship of the ECT was back in 1956. They beat Eastside 51-48, but on the turnover, Montclair, down by one, will have a chance to take the lead.
1:15, we're at crunch time, and there's a lot of time.
Kyle Anglin comes into the game. Jeff Mills will step out.
Again, the quickness of Montclair's man-to-man defense forced the turnover. Boy, Seton Hall's committed a lot of turnovers today.
They really have. It has not helped their game. That margin has really narrowed, though.
Yep.
It was 14-6 or 8 at one point. Anglin off the bench gives Montclair a lead with 59 seconds left.
The slicer sliced through and hit a jumper.
Here's a steal. Matthews has it and a chance for a three-point play and a timeout signal for by Montclair, or excuse me, by Seton Hall.
All of a sudden, it just happened. And it's the press again, not being able to get the ball out of the backcourt.
Montclair leads by three. Matthews, after this timeout, will have a chance to make it four. 51 seconds left. Anglin came off the bench, scored at the 59-second mark to give Montclair the 45-44 lead. Then the steal by Matthews, and he was fouled.
Here's a picture of the steal coming up. Let's look. Let's see it.
This is Anglin's
bucket.
Him the one-point lead.
Nice shot.
Coming off the bench. Falling away. Montclair listening to the words of Bob Lester.
The Wizard of Montclair. What they call John Wooden, the Wizard of
Westwood.
That's exactly right.
Here's Bobby Farrell. Let's see what he has to say. Well, we caught the last word. Ready.
Well, the prep has hung tough so far, and they've never seemed to lose their composure, so let's see what they do here.
It's a former prep star and Seton Hall University star, Mel Knight, standing in the corner to our left. And I'm sure if Bobby Farrell could do it, he'd say, Mel, you want to sneak into a uniform? We could use some magic at this point. Fred Matthews will step to the line looking to complete a three-point play. If he does, it will give Montclair a four-point lead. Matthews looking for his 15th point.
Done well from the foul line, hasn't he, Matt?
He has not missed a shot.
Oof.
Seton Hall led by Tom Cook with 12 points.
And he has still not missed a shot.
He has 9 points here in the fourth quarter. It's a four-point lead, 51 seconds left. And Cook is fouled, and that's not what Bob Lester wanted. Jeff Mills fouling Tom Cook, only 2 seconds off the clock, and if Cook hits these, it'll be a two-point game.
That's exactly what Bob Lester did not want.
It's a 1-1, so Cook must make the first in order to have the second.
He's a pretty good shooter, though.
Cook is 4-for-5 from the line today. Mills will come out of the game. Anglin will come in. Seton Hall has won them all this year, 22 in a row. Montclair, their last 10 have been in the win column, and they are 19-6. Cook missed it. Manning with the big rebound. Oh, in and out. It was halfway down. And a foul on Matt Lasher. I thought Madden had bought another big hoop.
He was halfway down.
And it came right back out. Lasher's second personal foul. Mills comes back into the game.
Big foul here, Bob, and this is I call you Bob. I told you I would.
You promised me at least one Bob in the game.
Matt, this is Matthews, who you said hasn't missed, and this will also give them the odd point.
43 seconds left.
Boy, has he been clutch.
10 points. 10 points for Fred Matthews in the fourth quarter.
They called him instant offense.
Well, it looks like Montclair will win its fourth Essex County Championship.
Not over yet, but it's getting late.
Montclair fans have started their celebration. Here's a near turnover. Cook has it. He stepped over the line, and Rick Sanfilippo caught him.
Now it looks like Bob Lester and the Mounties will win it. They're going to call a timeout.
Fourth consecutive appearance in the final for Montclair, and they will win their third championship in those four tries. There's Bob Lester. Just an outstanding coach. He does it with talent. He does it without talent. He's a great coach. There's no doubt about it.
There's no question about it. And that's not to say that Bobby Farrell's not a great coach.
No, not at all.
He's taken a young team, won, you know, 22 straight games. And sometimes the string runs out.
And it'll run out here this afternoon. Seton Hall still has not won an ECT final since back in 1956. I'd like to thank at this opportunity Joe Garvey, the tournament director of the ECT, and his committee for all their help. I think next year we're going to come back and try and do a couple of the preliminary games.
Like we used to.
Like we used to. Do some of the quarterfinal games and the semifinals. There were some truly great games played in this ECT this year. We want to thank Joe and his committee. The seedings sat up pretty well. The four top-seeded teams made it to the semifinals. Montclair with a minor upset over Barringer, the number two seed, 3-2 to advance to the final. Also like to thank Butch Fortunato, the athletic director at Montclair, and Bob Lester and his coaching staff, Sandy Hunter and Luther Bowen. And at Seton Hall, thank Joe Walsh, the athletic director, and Bobby Farrell and his coaching staff, Pete Butler, Mike Shepard Jr., and Marty Berman. Of course, I have to thank Richie Regan, the athletic director at Seton Hall. Seton Hall donates the use of Walsh Auditorium to the Essex County Tournament. No charge involved.
You know, Seton Hall Prep had the ball 44-43 and going towards their basket. They turned it over and haven't scored since.
Been outscored 7-0 since that point. 33 seconds left. Lasher in the forecourt. They'll have to put him up quick. No good. McDonald with the rebound. He is fouled by McCray. So these last 26 seconds may take a while, as Seton Hall will be in a position where they'll have to foul in order to stop the clock and have an opportunity to get back into this game. Now here's the question. Seton Hall has come all this way, undefeated. As we said, ranked by some papers as the number one team in the state. They lose, they've got to come back. They've got a semifinal game in Parochial A, North Jersey. Only four teams qualified. They'll take on Marist on March 1st. Can they do it? What kind of an effect does a loss like this have on a young team?
I think they'll come back. I think that we'll see them here in the state parochial finals.
Well, those games are on March 10th here at Seton Hall University, and TV3 will be bringing all four of the parochial games, the parochial A and B boys and girls finals from Seton Hall on March 10th. Seton Hall with a real strong opportunity to make it. Ironically, Seton Hall is seated second in North Jersey Parochial A behind Bergen Catholic. The reason being that at the time of the seedings, both teams were undefeated, and the tiebreaker was that quality of opposition, and they based that basically on group size. Bergen Catholic had played primarily Group 4 schools. Seton Hall, the same thing, but they played just a few more Group 3s, and so therefore, Bergen Catholic seated number one, Seton Hall number two. Cook misses them both. And we have a timeout following the Volsey basket. 10 points for Franz Volsey. 16 seconds left. It's a four-point game. Seton Hall not out of it. They'll need a quick turnover and a hoop.
We're going to have to foul them as soon as they throw the ball in. And now Bob Lester will probably try to get a five out there of his best ball handlers and what he would consider his best foul shooters.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't see what else Seton Hall could do but try to foul him as soon as it comes in. Hope for a miss and get it down there again, but it's a long shot, but it's a possibility.
Well, let me just review for you a little bit the ECT history of Bob Lester, not to continue to praise him, but he took over East Orange in 71-72. They were state champs, and they were runner-up in this tournament. In 72-73, they were state champs and runner-up in the tournament. Then in 73-74, they were ECT and state champs. In 74-75, ECT champs. 75-76, ECT champs and state champs. 76-77, they were county champs. He went down to Atlantic City, had two successful years, 19-8 and 19-4. Came back. In 78-79, they were semifinalists at Montclair. In 80-81, they were semifinalists at Montclair and runner-up in Group 4. 81-82, county champs in Group 4, runner-up. 82-83, county champs. 83-84, county runner-up. And in 84-85, it looks like they'll be county champs.
As old Casey Stengel used to say, amazing.
Amazing.
I think they gave a deliberate foul this time. And he will shoot two.
No, they're going to say 1-1. Jennings will be at the line for a 1-1.
1-1, okay. They only got 1 second off the clock, so a miss here and a Seton Hall rebound and a quick bucket.
I think Seton Hall's out of timeouts, though. So they'll have to foul.
There's a miss.
Cook with the rebound. Oh, Cook walked. Cook walked. Dave Cummings stepped in front of him and altered his move into the hoop, and he walked. Big turnover with 9 seconds left. Here's Madden's foul. Fouling Timmy Riddick.
As I said, they have a very small club in there, but I'm sure it's the best ball handling club. And as I said, what Bob Lester would consider his best foul shooting club.
Some of the fans have started to file out. A lot of them have lined themselves up along the baseline. You can see them on your screen behind the basket. And I'm sure at the last tick of the clock, they'll come charging on the court. Another miss. Volsey ahead to Madden. 5 seconds left. Madden puts it up, but they have no time left. There's 2 seconds left. They don't even have to inbound. They do. But Montclair has won the Essex County Tournament in 1985, their third championship in the last 4 years, their fourth in school history, and Bob Lester and the Mounties celebrate at midcourt, winning the ball game by a final score of 50-48. An exciting ball game, but Montclair pulled it out down the stretch, trailing at 1 point, 44-43. They moved it up to 50-44, outscoring Seton Hall 7-0. Then they had to hang on at the end, winning by 50-48 over Seton Hall. Seton Hall has lost its first ball game of the year. They dropped to 22-1. Montclair has now won 11 consecutive ball games. They are 20-6, and they have to be considered a team to look for in Group 4 play. They are on a big roll. We're going to take a break. We'll come back with a talk with Bob Lester and a couple of his players. Stay with us. To 48, the final score as Montclair wins its fourth Essex County Tournament Championship in the school's history, their third in their last 4 years. We'll speak with Fred Matthews, Quintus McDonald, and head coach Bob Lester. First, Fred, congratulations on your performance. Led all scorers with 19 points, 11 of them coming in the fourth quarter. What's going through your mind as it got down to crunch time in that seesaw battle, particularly since you went to the line so often under pressure situations?
Well, soon we got in the fourth quarter, and we scored 4 points straight. I knew then we had the momentum, and we just pulled it out. Just hit the four free throws straight, and I knew then we had the momentum of the game.
What was the team thinking? What was going on the bench and in the huddles during the timeouts as Seton Hall cut into that big lead? You had it up to 9 points, 27-18, early in the third quarter. Then they got right back in the ballgame and, in fact, led by a point at the end of the third quarter.
Yes, then they had momentum of the game, right? And then we just had to come back and just get it again, the momentum. And so once we got that, I knew we were winning.
11 straight wins now for Montclair. Have you staked your claim to a Group 4 title?
Yeah, if we're going to try this, go for it. Wherever it goes, just go.
All right, well, congratulations on your performance and the 19 points today. Good luck to the Mounties the rest of the season.
Thank you.
Fred Matthews, the leading scorer in today's ball game, and Quintus McDonald will now step in. And Quintus, 5 points tonight, but your contribution was down low. You wound up getting Seton Hall's Franz Volsey into foul trouble and negated some of his play tonight.
Well, my position on the basketball team really isn't as a scorer. I just hustle a lot down inside, try and keep things a little bit physical against the taller guys because they are much taller than I am. So try and keep it physical, and if I can pick up a couple of fouls, that's good to get the big guy out of the game for a little while, and that's what happened.
With that big lead early in the third quarter, Coach took the air out of the ball a little bit. I thought maybe he'd run and try and extend that lead, and Seton Hall got back. Did you ever think at one point that, oh boy, we had that opportunity and we blew it and maybe we won't win the title?
Well, Coach didn't take the air out of the ball. The players did that were out on the court. We got out there and we were playing a little bit lackadaisical, which was bad. And there was a time when they went up by one in the fourth quarter where I said, gee whiz, man, it would have been so much easier to come to the fourth quarter with that 7-point lead that we had at halftime or a little bit more. We could cruise in right now, but since we had lost it, kind of got upset. And that's when Fred stole the ball, hit the 3-point play, and we were on our way.
And the crowd erupted, the Montclair bench erupted. What's been the difference for this ball club? You won 11 in a row now. Can you attribute that that surge to anything in particular?
Well, we can attribute it to one particular game. But see, I can't say much about that game because I was away that weekend when they beat Bergen Catholic. I called my friends that night. They were like, oh man, you didn't hear about it. We won. I got so excited over the telephone that I get home and they explained the whole game to me. And it was really nice. They had beaten, you know, Bergen Catholic, which was ranked really high in the state at that time. And I was just glad for them. And we didn't lose since then. So I think that was the turning point in our season right there.
Again, the question I asked Fred, I'll ask you. What about Group 4 play? Your mind's got to focus on that now.
Well, that's true. And I said the turning point came with Bergen Catholic. We just turned another thing around this past week, and we beat Patterson Eastside, a team that we hadn't beaten in 7 straight games. We beat them in Passaic County, so we feel, well, I think the players feel pretty confident. Coach had confidence in us the whole season. He just told us he was going to be there waiting for us to come around. I think we've come around. It's time to play some more basketball.
Well, congratulations on your performance and the team's performance. Good luck in the playoffs, and again, congratulations to the Mounties.
Thanks a lot.
Quintus McDonald, the center for this team, comes off the bench, gives them some strength on the boards, and helped his club to the win. And Bob, I know I talked to you yesterday, and you said it's an important win in the Essex County final. You want to win in your own backyard. It's all the schools from the entire county, all sizes, parochial, public. And I guess that celebration at the end indicated your thoughts about winning it. Congratulations.
Well, thank you, Matt. I just thought Seton Hall had a fantastic team and that we would have to play a fantastic ball game in order to win. And when I looked up at the clock and saw we had a chance with about 30 seconds to go, I felt that emotion building up. And when that final horn went off, I just let it all out because we had to play a fantastic ball game to beat a well-coached, well-drilled, outstanding club like Seton Hall. And it's just fantastic to beat the number one team in the state.
10 times now you've taken a team to the final. Either at East Orange or here at Montclair, 10 times in 12 years, 7 times you've come away with the championship. You said yesterday that it's really nothing to do with coaching. You were downplaying that. You're saying the players do it all. But you said you know how to win these games, and you let the players know how to win it, and then they go and do it. So what's the secret?
Well, one of the things is, for example, against a team like Seton Hall, our game plan was to bring them out of that zone early as we possibly can. In order for that to happen, we had to get the lead. So therefore, we had to come out with a charge and not fall behind. Once we got the lead, we were able to bring them out of the zone. So I knew what to do, but it was up to the kids to do it. I'm the mind, they're the body. So we're working very closely together. We're interdependent. I can't do anything without them, and they could probably get along without me.
I'm not so sure about that, Bob. Certainly you are an outstanding coach, great technician, and you've done well wherever you have been. Group 4 play now. I know you want to enjoy this victory. I hate to mention Group 4 play. There are a lot of outstanding teams in this section and, of course, in North 1 also. But your team is on a roll.
Yeah, we're rolling, but we haven't done well in the last 2 years in the state tournament. We open up with Westfield at our place, and then if we're fortunate enough to win that one, we have to go to Elizabeth, which is going to be a monumental task. But as you said, we're on a roll now, Matt, and no matter what the situation is, I'll take this team anywhere. We'll go to Elizabeth if we beat Westfield, and I'll feel just as confident as I did feel for this game. I felt thought we could win it if we did the things right. And I feel we can go down to Elizabeth and win, but we're going to have to play another Super Bowl game.
Well, Bob, congratulations on winning this contest. 11 in a row. You're now 20, another 20-win season on your ledger, and good luck to the Mounties in the playoffs.
Thanks a lot, Matt. Really appreciate it.
Bob Lester, head coach of the Montclair Mounties, as his team wins another championship, and he adds another one to his ledger.
I told him he's a great coach, and he ranks with any of them. You just can't do any better. Very interesting fellow to talk to over there. I was talking to him while you were interviewing the two Montclair players. A very interesting person, and a lot of confidence and a lot of knowledge of what he's doing.
And he led his team to the win this afternoon, capturing the 39th edition of the Boys Essex County Tournament. The final score, once again, Montclair 50, Seton Hall Prep 48. For the coach, Ed Lyons, I'm Matt Laughlin. Thanks for joining us, and so long from Walsh Auditorium on the campus of Seton Hall University.
It's a typical practice. You got to be loose, but you got to make sure the work gets done too. And Montclair coach Bob Lester hasn't earned his winning reputation by letting someone else do the work. You see, he's in there with his kids, urging them on at practice, explaining what he wants and how he wants it done.
So what we want to do today is work on getting over top of those screens, so therefore we'll be closer to our man and less likely to lose him. And this is the type of defense that we want, tight man-to-man defense.
Montclair started this season slowly, with just a mediocre 7-6 record, but Coach Lester's patience paid off, didn't it, David?
We had our problems. It was pretty up and down, but Coach waited for us, and we came around, and once things fell into place, we felt we were unstoppable.
Number 21, Quintus McDonald, is kind of quick and kind of strong, too. And prior to his powerful contributions to the Mounties basketball program this winter, he was one of the most sought-after football recruits in the nation. This coming fall, he's headed to Happy Valley to play football for Joe Paterno's Nittany Lions. But it's the basketball season that made for the moments to remember for the team that learned how to play together, winning 14 straight, finishing up with a 21-win, 7-loss record.
Got to be the ECT championship game against Seton Hall. I mean, we played such a great game, knocking off the number one team in the state.
No matter how much talent you have, if the guys don't blend well as a unit, then you're not going to have success. I think this year's team was a perfect example of that. We had teamwork, and we were 21-7 Essex County champs, and just a fantastic group of individuals I was able to work with this year, and I'm very proud of them.
Ah, those Mounties. We'll be watching them next year, too, and they will be worth watching because 8 juniors and 1 sophomore are returning. From this year's Team of the Month roster, they should be contenders again next year.
Something of this nature could go on.
When you have an athlete like Quintus McDonald, he comes along once in a while, and the whole world watches when he comes along, and they all want a piece of him. What do you tell them?
Well, as a coach, I try to give him as much guidance as I possibly can, as much as he needs. Tell him to watch out for the people who I call hangers-on. There's always people around that are looking to get close to these kids. Some have good intentions, many have bad intentions. And I try to also stress talking to your parents. Have a good relationship with your parents, because they're going to be the ones, I think, that's the first line of defense, the parent guidance at home. So the little bit that I can give them as a coach, added to what they get at home, plus what others would give them, those people that are around them at other periods of time, I think the combination of those things would go along to help guide the young man straight. That's if all of us are giving him the correct information.
What is an information? What kind of information? You were one of the most widely recruited young men in the state's history. You wound up at Penn State. What happened before then? Were you offered things like women, drugs on campuses?
Well, no. You really aren't offered those types of things. Those things come along
only whenever a recruiter comes out and he sees that's the type of person you are. I think that happens only after you represent yourself to them. You have to show them the type of person that you are and let them know your basic character.
And you tell them before. How do you tell them? What's the code word?
I don't know. I guess you just have to be yourself. If they realize that that's the type of person you are and that you're willing to go for things like that and that you'll take that as a basis of, yeah, I'll go to this school because they can give me women, money, cars, houses, or whatever. If you want to go for those reasons, then maybe they will offer them to you. But if they realize from the start that you're not the type of person that's going to take those things as leeway to go to that school, they won't offer it because they'll feel they're wasting their time and they're putting their program down to affect in your eyes that you just say, well, I just don't even want to go there because they're doing those things.
But you know that those things occur, so you were wary of it happening. Did you hear about them? Were there any particular schools you're worried about it?
Well, you hear about those things just coming up through high school. A lot of people say, well, so-and-so could have gotten this, so-and-so could have gotten that. But I just take all those things when people say it as basically a rumor. And I don't believe too much of hearsay unless I see it myself. So no one offered me anything, and I just won't say that it's happening. I can't say that it's happening because it didn't happen to me.
Did the coach at Penn State offer you anything special?
No, not at all.
What do you get at Penn State?
Free education.
It's pretty hard to get an education today when you're playing football and you have 3 hours of practice every day, 4 days a week, a game on Saturday, all-star games, things like that.
It's definitely hard, but if you want the education bad enough, you can get it, I think.
Were you surprised about all these scandals, drug scandals, drug abuse scandals, point-shaving scandals?
Well, I had seen it before in the past, like in professional, like my coach said, but whenever it happened, I guess I was surprised at the fact that it did happen and they got caught or whatever. But I don't know, I just never really realized that things like that went on.
Were you ever offered drugs in high school while you were playing?
While I was playing, what?
Anybody come up and say, listen, if you win the game for us, we'll give you some extra drugs after it's over, things like that?
Oh, no, no one does that.
Coach, is that true? You were telling our producer, Guy Gorman, that athletes are offered women and a lot of other things.
I would, on certain recruiting trips, this has gone on, Alan. I've been coaching in the state of New Jersey for 14 years on a high school level, and I've had a few athletes, not very many, but a few who have been highly recruited. And I've seen some of the recruiting tactics used by some of these characters, and I have
tell us some of those incidents.
Without getting too specific, without trying to put a burden on any institution, I'll just give some of the things in general. For example, one athlete was going to go on a recruiting trip to a major university, and the assistant coach.
How long ago was this?
This was, I would say, at least 10, 12 years ago, in my early years of coaching. The recruiter said in front of me and in front of the young man, well, we definitely want you to come out to our place for a visit. What would you like when you got out there? When you get out there, and the young man said, well, what do you mean? What are you talking about? He said, well, what kind of woman do you want? We're going to set you up with a woman for the weekend. And this is widespread, I think, in football and basketball. At least it was then. When a kid comes to a school to look the school over to see if it's a good school for him, they want to make it as inviting and enticing as they possibly can.
Well, you got a guy who can do both basketball and football. A lot of times the only way to get to the athlete is to get to the parents or to the coach. Were you offered anything?
I had been offered some things. For example, one recruiter came in and asked me if I wanted to be the coach of the McDonald's All-Star game. Or how would you like, if we can get this kid, how would you like to come along and be the assistant coach? But I have to agree with Quintus. I think they begin to use those tactics once they get desperate. And if they feel that they have a chance to get a kid without using those tactics, they won't, because they really don't want to bring their program or that bad part of their program out unless it's absolutely necessary.
But yet you know about it. What are some of those? Who are some of those schools?
I would not, Alan, I would not mention any of the schools, because if the coach is not who did this particular incident, if he's not there at this particular time, then it might be an injustice to the school.
Can you tell us who the coach was?
I would not tell you who the coach is, and I would not want to do that, because I just think it's unfair. But I can honestly say it does happen.
It does happen.
It does happen.
Well, the concern by a lot of people is that perhaps if they don't get it at the high school level, there's no way to get to those people. They become college stars, then they become professional stars, those few who can make it, and then it's all over. There's no chance then.
Well, once again, I think you have to be concerned with who tries to get around the kid. I think at Montclair
High
School...
What do you tell this guy? He looks like he's going to be a good football player. Now he's having a relaxed time. He's a dominant high school player, but pretty soon he's going to be playing in a very, very tough league, in Penn State, and all kinds of pressures, drug pressures, all kinds of pressures. What do you tell him? What has he told you?
Well, he's just told me to watch out. Like he said, watch out for the hangers-on, and that I think the hangers-on will be left behind here in Montclair.
What's a hanger-on?
Well,
both of you.
Uh-huh. Well, I would say a hanger-on, and there are many categories, as I explained earlier. There are those who come around practice or that are around the kids for a number of reasons. You have those who are around the kids and around practice simply because they're dedicated fans. They're there because they want to be there and offer support. There are those who are often there because they just want to see what's going on and might get a few secrets, or they come to, you know, check out your coaching philosophy. Then there are those who have devious intentions.
What is a devious intention?
Well, let me give you an example of what happened to me once when I was at East Orange. A guy I thought was a buddy of mine asked me if he could come to practice. I said, sure, come on in. And he watched practice, and we had a kid, a sophomore, who was about 6'6" at our school. And after practice, he talked to the kid. I thought, no problem, because I knew the guy. I didn't think he would do anything that wasn't correct. The next week, the kid transferred out of my school into another school in a different county. They also got his mother a job, a better job than the one she had, because she didn't have a very good job. And he just swept the kid right on out of our program. Now, this is what I call a hanger-on, a guy who comes around, and you have to check out what his purposes, his reasons, his intentions for being there are. And
I can't believe, I don't want to interrupt you, I can't believe that, let's say, you said that your finalists were Penn State, USC, UCLA, and Notre Dame. Those are schools with some kinds of reputations, although USC has had some problems. What I'd like to know is what the other schools told you. If those are your finalists, who are the other schools, and what did they tell you? Did they offer you anything special? Cars?
No, none of these
schools. Or are they nervous?
Well, I guess they may have been nervous because, like I said earlier, they kind of sense the type of person you are whenever they first meet you, when they come into the office, the way you walk, the way you talk, whatever.
The high school, but the college coach doesn't have to do that. He has a recruiter, and sometimes a recruiter is not attached to the school. He's an alumnus. It's good for business to have a big, strong football player who might lead his team to a national championship.
Right, but all the college recruiters that I dealt with were affiliated with the program. They weren't alumni. They were all some type of coach or another. And I feel like they can sense the type of person you are. And if you're a low kind of character who's going to go for those types of things, then maybe they will offer them to you. But if you're not, I mean, if you're proud about what you're doing and you know that you want to work for what you get and you want a really strong education, you don't want to just go to school and play football and get out with no degree or nothing at all, you mess around and get hurt, and you have nothing left to fall back on. And I don't want that. And I think they all sense that whenever they come in to talk to me. So no one was offering me anything like that.
Probably the most recruited player in America 4 years ago was a fellow named Patrick Ewing. And Coach John Thompson of Georgetown made sure that he was kept away from the media. Felt that the only way, and this is my last question, the only way for him to survive 4 years of high-pressure basketball was to avoid meeting with the media. Is that the way to do it?
I don't know if keeping him away from the media is the best thing to do, but I do think keeping him isolated from shady individuals, shady characters, I think in that sense, I think John did a very good job. I've never tried to keep my players away from the media, because I think dealing with the media, answering the questions that they're going to ask, and being able to handle the situations is good for them. It'll help them in their growth. And I think just coming down to a program like this will help Quintus one day, because I think Quintus is going to be a very successful football player. Possibly he will have a shot at the professional ranks. But I think being able to handle a situation like this and getting it early will be good for him. And this is what I think Montclair is very good about, in that the parental backing in Montclair is very good. I think one of the reasons that not too much was offered to Quintus, because Quintus had a good background.
Not too
when
much.
They came.
What do you mean by not too much? That's a final question.
Well, because every kid, every person has a certain point in which they will, I think, in which they will break. Some breaking points a little bit.
What was
bit,
a small thing that Quintus was offered?
I don't know what small thing.
Just a small thing that you were offered. I don't know about.
Small
not
thing
too
that
much. You said there was not too much.
I was offered a full free ride education to Penn State University.
I hope you get it, Quintus. I hope you become an All-American football player, and you come back here 4 years and tell us about it. I want to thank you very much, Bob Lester.
Thank you, Alan.
Hope we see you again. I'm Alan Wolper for Right to Know. Stay tuned for more on recruiting pressures, drugs, and other things that are making high school and college coaches nervous today.